goodbye to the lion. Hello, everyone. A little bit about myself. My name is Shany Michaely. I live in Tel Aviv in Israel. I'm a software engineer at Mellanox Technologies. What I do, I write drivers for FreeBSD. If you were wondering, I like to play basketball. I like running. I love my Labrador dog, which I have. And of course, to travel around the world and to Ottawa to give lectures for FreeBSD. I'm a bit anxious, so be kind. So what are we going to speak today? We're going to talk about InfiniBand general overview, okay? InfiniBand is a computer networking communication standard. So we're going to understand what is InfiniBand, how do I work with it, what is the main idea behind it, what are the key components of it, and what are its advantages. From there, we're going to go to RDMA introduction. RDMA is Remote Direct Memory Access. This is one of InfiniBand's more important components. So we're going to understand how do we work with it, and what does it give us, and again, the advantages of it. Then we're going to talk about RoCE. RoCE is actually RDMA over Converged Ethernet. So if I already have an Ethernet deployment, and I still want to use RDMA and want to use InfiniBand, want to use the perks of RDMA on it, then how do I do it? I use RoCE, okay? We're going to see the flow of RoCE. We're going to understand how we use it. And the last one, iSER introduction. iSER is actually a storage protocol, okay? It's iSCSI on RDMA. So in here, we're going to see how everything we talked about so far is reflected and how do we use it and what does it give us. So let's start. We're going to talk about Ethernet versus InfiniBand. I'm not going to talk much about Ethernet, just going to mention it, as I'm sure all of you are very much familiar with it and know much more about it than me. So we're going to focus more about InfiniBand, and we're going to talk about its key components, and we see how we get the whole picture together, okay? We're going to take step by step till we understand how do we work with it and what does it give us. So InfiniBand, as I said, is a network architecture, is an open standard, okay, so it's not owned by anyone. InfiniBand has low latency, under 1 microsecond, and has high bandwidth, up to 100 gigabit per port, per second per port. InfiniBand has low CPU overhead, okay, and the RDMA, the thing that I talked about, also this is the component that helps us with the low CPU overhead, and it has fabric consolidation and low energy usage. InfiniBand can consolidate networking and storage data over a single fabric and one subnet, which significantly lowers the overall power and management overhead that is required. So in fact, I can actually have a fabric of like 10K nodes, okay, in one subnet, and the routing process is also determined in layer 2, okay, between all of these 10K nodes. So in one sentence, we can say InfiniBand is a high-speed, low CPU overhead, a high-efficient server and storage interconnect technologies. So a little bit about InfiniBand layers. We have our edge node, the physical layer, the link layer. We have the network layer, transport layer, and of course the ULPs, the upper layer protocols, and the applications. In between, we also have the switches and the routers. Quick look of InfiniBand packet. We have here the LRH, which is a local route header, okay? We must have an LRH on each InfiniBand packet. It's addressed with a lead, okay? And the next one is a GRH, which is a global route header, okay? We address it with a GID. And the GID is actually, its presentation, it's like IPv6. It's a 128-bit, okay? Then we have the base transport header. Here is another header where we keep information about our data, about InfiniBand payload that we're sending. The extension header, again, more information about the data, about the sort of send that I'm using. We'll get to it. We have here immediate data if you want to mention certain data, and the message payload, of course. And at the end, we have our checksums. Okay, so this is an InfiniBand packet. Now, just a quick overview of the driver of how does it work. We have our InfiniBand link layer, okay? We refer to InfiniBand as IB also. So we have our InfiniBand link layer. Above that, we have our IB vendors, okay, with our ports and the traffic that goes in and out. And about the vendors, we have our IB core. So let's go through a quick flow of how does it work. I have my application. The application sits above the IB core, okay? It chooses the vendor that it wants to work with, okay? And then it sends actually requests to the IB core. So it uses the API of the IB core. Then the IB core gets these requests, and according to the vendor that I chose, the application chose, it actually calls the right callback in the right vendor. Then the right vendor uses the right function, which goes down to firmware and to link layer, and so on, okay? So a few more facts about InfiniBand. InfiniBand has a subnet manager. A subnet manager is actually kind of like the brain of InfiniBand, okay? The subnet manager is the brain behind InfiniBand, the most important entity responsible for configuring and managing an InfiniBand subnet. So like I said before, that we have all the routing process established in layer two, this is done because of the subnet, or the subnet manager actually does it. Okay, so what else does it do? Fill stably the node's port, like we said, the forwarding tables, assign each port in an add node with a local identifier with a lead, okay? So a lead is a unique in a subnet. Each port can get more than one lead, you can get a range of leads, and in a switch, all of the ports have the same lead, just so you know. And one SM is active at every given moment. So kind of like we all have one brain, and if we had, okay, most of us have one brain, and if we had two, then it will be messy. So also InfiniBand, it has one brain, so one SM is active at every given moment. We have a substitute, so whenever SM stop function, then another SM becomes active and take over. A little bit about InfiniBand resources. So I'll start with the QP. The QP is actually the actual object that transfers data. It has independent send and receive queues. So we can see here the send queue and the receive queue. So whenever I want to send a packet, whenever I have a send test that I want to send to the hardware, then I put it on a send queue. And wherever I want to receive packets, I receive information, I use the receive queue for that. So inside the QP, I have a send and a receive queue. Next thing is a completion queue. A completion queue, also refers to C queue, is a queue that holds information regarding all completed tasks. So whenever the hardware finished with the task that I gave her, it actually let me know on the completion queue. Okay, I have let's call it for now, a new task on the completion queue, and I pull it, and then I can know if the task that I gave the hardware was successful, and if not, so what was the error, what was wrong with it. Also, we have our memory region, okay? So memory region is a virtually contiguous memory block that was registered. What do you mean by register? It was prepared and actually pinned to the memory so it won't be swept out. Every memory region has its access permissions, so I can choose if I want to let remote nodes to write or read to my memory, and I give myself also permissions if I can only read from this memory or if I can also write to this memory, so I have actually permissions. I can use the same buffer, by the way, and register it multiple times, each time with different permissions. And also, for each buffer that was registered, we get two keys. We get an L key and an R key. An L key is actually a local key. So whenever I want to reach my memory, I need to have this local key. I need to use the L key in order to do that. And whenever a remote node wants to reach my memory, it has to use a remote key that I gave him, okay? So in order for a remote node to do something, to read or write data to or from my memory region, it needs to use a remote key. And we'll talk about this a bit later when we talk about RDMA. Then you'll see when we use this R key. And if you see here, then we have these blocks that are already written with data, and these are on the send queue, and what we get in the receive queue, we put in a blank memory blocks. So we fill them with data, actually, that we got. Last thing in here, last resource I want to talk about is the address handler. So an address handler actually describes the path from a local to remote ports. The routing is done based on the information in the address handler. So whenever I want to connect to a remote node, I need to know the path to it, okay, the route. And so I have this address handler, which I keep this information in. Now I can save this address handler in QP, okay, in my QP context, or I can save it on the task, okay? We will see when everything is done, why and when it's done. So these are our resources that we will use. Now we have also transport types. Now there are four major transport types in InfiniBand. First is unreliable datagram, UD. UDQP can receive and send messages to or from any other UDQP. Reliability is not guaranteed, and each message is limited to one packet, okay? This is kind of like a UDP, but in a much lower level, okay? Second one is RC, it's a reliable connected. RCQP is connected to a single RCQP, so reliability is guaranteed, supports operation that needs acknowledgement. So we have, with RCQP, we have integrity, we have reliability, and we promise that all our packets has arrived, which is kind of like TCP, but in a much lower level. Then we have also DC. This is actually kind of a combination between an RC and a UD. It's actually a new transport type. It supports all of the features provided by RC and hardware reliability, while allowing processes to communicate with any remote process with just one DCQP. So it's a little bit UD and a little bit RC. So if I have this big subnet, like we said, with 10K nodes or with a lot of nodes, and I want one node to communicate with all the other nodes, then I need one node to have a lot of QPs, which means a lot of a memory that he needs to remember, a lot of connection memory that he needs to remember. So that's why we have this DCQP. So I can, each time I can connect to one QP, use it as an RCQP for the reliability, then connect to a new QP, use it also as an RCQP, and I don't need to remember all this connection information. And last one I want to talk about is UC. I'm just going to mention it because we're not going to talk about it in this lecture. UCQP connected to a single UCQP, reliability is not guaranteed. Just so you know, but in this lecture, I will focus more about RCQP and UDQP a little bit. I will mention it. When I said before that the address handler, if you remember, sometimes I keep it on a QP context, sometimes I keep it on a task. So when we're talking about RCQP, which is connected to one QP, then I'll keep the path memory, I'll keep my address handler, all the information about the remote node, the route to it, I'll keep it on the QP, because it's connected to one QP, while when I'm dealing with UDQP, which can connect each time to a different QP, then I will keep this address handler on a certain task, okay? Now, when I'm saying tasks, what are these tasks that I'm talking about? Let's see what are work queues. I have a work request, okay? So a task is actually a work request, a work item that the hardware should perform. So whenever I want the hardware to send things, okay, I actually post a work request, okay, of send. So where do I post it? On the send queue. So I tell the hardware I want to send a packet, so I post a work request of send on my send queue. Okay, so I have two working queues actually. Work queue is a queue that contains the work request. I have two work queues. I have a send queue, like we saw on the QP, and I have a receive queue. Okay? And every work request that I have, it's considered as outstanding until the hardware posts a work completion on my completion queue. So when the hardware is done with what I have X to do, with what the task that I gave it, then he posts a work completion. Okay, and then he tells me, like I said, like we said before, in the completion queue, if the test was okay, if the work is accomplished, or if not, so what was the error, what is wrong, and so on. So I just I want to show you a little bit of these opcodes, okay, of work requests. So I have RDMA write here. I have work request send. I have send with immediate, RDMA read, and a lot of others. If you will work with InfiniBand, then you'll probably know a lot of them. I want to go back a little bit to my chart from before. So we said before that the application that sits above the IB core actually sends it requests. So what are these requests that the application sends? It actually uses verbs, okay, in order to communicate with the IB core. So what are verbs? Verbs actually is an abstract description of the functionality that is provided for application. It is not an API, and there are several implementations for it. Now, I should have said before, everything that I'm talking about InfiniBand, you can find it, and of course more, in InfiniBand spec. Now, in InfiniBand spec, if you read the spec, you see that in terms of how I allocate resources or how I send data, everything, I don't have API there. I have, okay, you need to allocate a QP, and you need to allocate a completion queue, but it doesn't say how to do it. So over the years, a more firm API was established, and this is the API that I'm going to show you that we use. But just so you know, the spec actually describes verbs as of what should we do. Verbs can be divided into two major groups. We have the control path, which manages the resources. If I want to allocate a QP, like we said, allocate a CQ, and so on. And I have the data path. It uses the resources to send and receive data. So if I want to send something, I need to post a work request, so I'm using the data path, okay? These are examples for verbs. I have the create AH, create QP, modify QP if I want, and I have the post send and the post receive. So now that we know more or less what is InfiniBand, I want to talk about RDMA, which we said before is the more important capability of InfiniBand. So RDMA, as we said, is remote direct memory access. So what does it mean? Like we said, one of the key capabilities of InfiniBand, it actually enables data transfer between servers and between server and storage with minimal involvement of the host CPU in the data path. So like my picture over here, it's actually like picking the remote's brain. So I'm picking his brain, I can write to it things, I can read from it, but it's without his awareness and he's not aware of what am I doing. So yeah, it's I'm above the law, I can do it. And of course, it's but he lets me do it, as we see. So in order to understand how RDMA works, I wanna go over the traditional model for 1 second. So we're talking here about send. It's just like the classic model. Data is read in local side. It's sent over the wire as a message, and remote side specify where the message will be saved. And we can see over here, we have the requester, and we have the responder. The responder must post a receive request over here, okay? So each message must consume one receive request that the responder must post. In the receive request, it actually mentions where the data is gonna be saved. Okay, and then the requester posts send request, only data passed on the wire. The responder pulls the CQ to see, okay, to see if he has a work completion, like we said before, if it went fine or not, and he sends an acknowledgement if we talk about a reliable transport type. Now, in RDMA. RDMA data transfer module, use it for either read or write. Local side can write data, like we said, directly to remote side memory. Also, local side can read data directly from remote side memory. Remote side isn't aware of any activity, no CPU involvement at remote side. So how is it done? We have, again, the requester and the responder. The requester posts send request. Data and remote memory attributes are sent. So like we said before, if I want to read or I want to write data to the remote node, first of all, the remote node must give me an access permission to do it. So when he registered its memory, he must have sent that he can do a remote read or remote write to it. And moreover, it must send me an RoCE. Now, when he sends me the RoCE, of course, it's a regular send, but he can send me one RoCE and one address, so I'll know where to reach one time, and then I can do as much as RDMA reads and writes as I want. So still, I'm saving a CPU. And then again, you can see the responder is totally passive. He doesn't do anything. I'm getting an acknowledgement, okay? The requester pulling the CQ to get an acknowledgement. By the way, if I use a RDMA read, then actually the data that I read is my acknowledgement, because I know I did it if I have data that I read. And the responder, again, doesn't do a thing. A little bit of performance that we have with InfiniBand. This is, as you can see, in 100 gigabits. So we get to line rate, okay, in InfiniBand bandwidth in about 1K. And when we have also InfiniBand latency, like I said before, then we get less than a 1 microsecond, okay? Okay, so who knows this one? RoCE. So like I said before, now I know what is InfiniBand, I know what is RDMA, I want to use it, but I have already an Ethernet network and an Ethernet deployment, and I don't want to change all of my network in order just to use RDMA. So for that, we have RoCE. RoCE is RDMA over Converged Ethernet, which means I can use RDMA and I can use InfiniBand and I can use it's a great performance, but I will use it on Ethernet. So we'll go back to our lovely chart. We used to have InfiniBand link layer. Now, hop, we have Ethernet link layer instead. And if we have Ethernet link layer, we also need to load, we also need EN vendors, okay? Now, why do we need the EN for? The Ethernet has two major jobs, okay, with RoCE. First of all, it's configuration of the port. I don't have a subnet manager anymore. I need something, someone to configure my port, give it a MAC address, expose it, and manage it for that minute on. And communication with the network stack for routing purposes. I need to communicate with the network stack. So actually, I need to load my EN module. So when running with RoCE, the EN module has to be loaded as well. Okay, this is a fact that you need to remember. Now, RoCE packet. So we saw before an InfiniBand packet, which is this packet. I'm not going to go over it again. And now we have RoCE version 1 packet. And you can see this is the IB packet without the LRH. And the Ethernet header is actually wrapping the InfiniBand packet. Okay, so now routing is done by the Ethernet header and not by the LRH. So here is the IB, and here is the Ethernet header, and it checks someone at the end. Just a quick mention of RoCE versions. Now, the version that is implemented into FreeBSD upstream is version 1 of RoCE, okay, this one. But we are working on a version 2, which will be implemented soon and will be pushed into upstream in the near future. You can see that in version 2, I also have an IP header, which means that version 2 can be routable. For now, the version which is in FreeBSD is non-routable. Okay? If I'll do my job quick, then you'll get it soon. If not, so maybe not, but I'll try my best. Now, a little bit of RoCE flow. I'm opening a new QP, okay? It can be either, like we said, an RC QP, and it could be a UD QP. What the thing I need to do first is actually connecting the QP to another QP. Now, I do it using RDMA CM. So communication should be established between the connected QPs. In order to connect the QPs, we need to exchange information. We have two ways to do so. We can do it out of bound, for example, with sockets or with a management port, or we can do it by using Communication Manager, which is the CM. So actually, if we have a requester and a responder, then the requester sends a CM request, and then the responder answers him with information. And it's actually like a few steps in this process, and it's represented with events. So we're sending an address resolve event and a route resolve event, and each time we get an event, then the process is getting to the end. until we get the established event, which means the connection has been established. Now, the required fields are the QP number of the other side, the GID addresses. We said GRH, we address it with the GID. So I need to know my source GID and the destination GID, and my source MAC, the destination MAC. So actually, we give the application the destination IP, and after the connection, the connecting process is done, we have all the information that we need to put in the address handler, the route to the other side, in order to send our packets. These are, I just want to show you example. These are the events, okay? This is the address resolve, address error if we have an error, route resolve, until we get the established over here. These are a few of the functions. Okay, RDMA resolve address, these are all in IB core, RDMA resolve IP, address resolve, and of course we have a lot more. All of this code, by the way, is now in SIS offered drivers InfiniBand core. So if you want to go check it out, you can, because it's all in upstream. So I mentioned GIDs before, so I just want to explain what it is very, very shortly. The driver manages actually a table of configured GIDs for each port. The hardware reads the GIDs from the table and uses them when sending a RoCE packet. We said in a RoCE packet we have a GRH header, okay? And we need to address it with GIDs. So the driver actually handles a table, and whenever the hardware needs to build the packet, it uses the GIDs over there and put them in the packet. Now, the version that we have now, it's a IP-based GIDs, okay? So the GIDs are based on our IP. So whenever we configure a port with an IP, IPv4, IPv6, we need to convert it into a GID, and then the hardware, they put it on the table, and then the hardware will know to put it on the packet when it sends it. We continue with our flow. Saving routing information, okay, we got these two QP connected, now we need to save the information. We do it, like we said before, in an RC QP, we save the information on the QP, in the QP context, and in the UDQP, we save the information on the work request, because each time I can send the work request, send data to another QP. In this QP, by the way, also, we save it on the QP each time, because we said it acts like an RC QP. We are sending the data. We chose before if we want to use opcode of RDMA read or RDMA write, or if we just want to do a regular send, and we put it also in the right places for the hardware to take it for the headers in the packet, and then we're sending the data according to the opcode that I chose, and of course put the data also in the memory to be sent. And then the hardware actually builds the packet. It takes all the information that I put in the right fields and builds the packet and sends it to the other side. The other side receives the RoCE packet, and according to what that was defined earlier as to what version of RoCE do I work with and what is RoCE, then the hardware knows how to read the packet and how to read its headers and take the data and read the data that it wants for it, or if it's RDMA write, then the other side doesn't do anything, of course, like we said before. And we have a connection and a transfer of data, so these two kids can talk now, and that's it. Now, one thing I wanna say also about RoCE, when we use RoCE, we need to do it on a lossless Ethernet, okay? In order to use RoCE, we need lossless Ethernet. Of course, I'm sure you all know also better than me, you can do it with pause frames inside a subnet, or we can do it also with ECN across subnet. So we have the way to achieve lossless Ethernet, but we need to remember just that when you use RoCE, we gotta make sure that we do it on lossless Ethernet. A little bit performance of RoCE. Okay, well, this is RoCE bandwidth. You can see that we get also to line rate, it's a 40 gigabit, okay, here. And if we look at this TCP bandwidth, you can see that this is the message size. So you can see that here we get it in around 1K and here in around 2. And this is a RoCE latency versus TCP latency. And like we said here, we get under 1 microsecond. And in here, we reach about 10. And this is TCP, of course. Okay, so we got to the last subject, and I did it quick. So we know what is InfiniBand, RDMA, and RoCE. Now I said I'm going to go through iSER, which is a storage protocol, just to understand a little bit how do we use it and what does it give us. So we have our chart as before. We have the InfiniBand core and the vendors, and now we have also Ethernet or InfiniBand. I want to start with SCSI. SCSI is a storage protocol, like we said before. It's actually a set of standards for connecting and transferring data between a computer and its devices. It defines protocols and it defines commands. But SCSI is actually a standalone on the machine, so it doesn't use a connection management. So it uses me as a storage protocol on my machine. But if I want to connect to other machines and to exchange information with them, then I cannot use SCSI. For that, I need a management layer. So for that, I have a SRP. Okay, SRP runs over InfiniBand, over IB Core. And also, I have iSCSI. iSCSI actually, it's another management layer which runs over a TCP/IP and over Ethernet. So when I use SCSI, I can actually choose if I want to run it over InfiniBand and use the SRP, or if I want to run it over Ethernet and use the iSCSI. Now I have here iSER in between. So iSER actually extends the use of iSCSI to use also RDMA. Okay, so when I'm using iSER, I'm actually using the management layer of iSCSI, so I run over Ethernet, but I use also the RDMA, actually, the IB Core. So it's kind of like RoCE, actually, so iSER actually uses RoCE. Now, the alpha version of iSER is currently under review, okay, and it also will be pushed to FreeBSD. And it also added the iSER itself and also added a little bit of code to iSCSI in order to have the choice of choosing whether to run with TCP or with the iSER. A little bit of how iSER works. I have the initiator and I have the target. Now, whenever the initiator wants to read or write data to or from the target, what it does, it actually sends an ARCHI, okay? And then the target is the one that is using RDMA read and RDMA write to the initiator. So if I'm the initiator and I want to write data to the target, then I send the ARCHI and I tell him what I want to do. And then the target actually uses RDMA read and reads the data to his memory without the involvement of the initiator. And again, if I'm the initiator and I want to read data from the target, then I send the ARCHI. And the target actually use RDMA write and write data to the initiator. Okay, and at the end, it actually sends a finish, says that it was done. And a little bit performance, okay, of iSER. So this is the initiator IO per second. We have here 16 connections, and you can see we increase the cores, and we get to 16. And this is iSER, so with iSER, we get 2000K, while we can see with iSCSI, then we're just about here, okay? These, by the way, are the cores on the target. So in here, it's only 2K, two cores on the target, but in here, we use 16 cores. This was message rate, and this is one connection. This is bandwidth, so we can see that now the colors are different. So now the red is iSER. So it's not my fault. So now the iSER also can reach LAN rate, okay, while increasing the block size. And you can see that with iSCSI, we get to about half of it. Okay, I'm done. Any questions? Yes.
Several slides back when you had when you were showing the stack on the storage side.
The what?
You were showing the stack up on the storage side.
Just tell me where to stop.
Yeah, this. Right here. In this case, it shows that iSCSI and iSER are both part of the same, stack.
Well, it's not really according to stacks. I just wanted to see how each of them are using the other one, but it's not I didn't try to build stacks here. So that wasn't my...
Okay, because you had them on the subscript chart showing them as being, you know, dependent.
No, but it's just to show that these are the management layers and this is the layer. Okay. It wasn't my purpose.
Okay.
Yes. SRP on FreeBSD, I'm not sure. Are there any plans to do SRP on FreeBSD?
Actually, we're working on ICE. We're working on ICER, as you know.
Yeah, that's great.
For now, I guess there are no plans, but if you want, you have my email. I'll show it again, and if there's a request, you can send an email, and we can think about it, I guess. Yeah. The what again?
The version 1 part
of RoCE? It's inside the offset stack. So in InfiniBand drivers. What?
It's in the latest offset stack?
Yeah. In the latest offset stack, you have in the core and in InfiniBand.
And your plan is to do version 2 as well?
Yes. We're working on it these days. When I'm not here, that's what I'm doing. Yes. I'm not very familiar with the iWarp, so I can't answer this question, but maybe there's someone here that did them both, or maybe he can answer, but I'm not sure which is better. I love RoCE better, because that's what I do, but I'm not sure. Sorry. Oh, yeah, you can ask him about iWarp. Ah, that's what you wanted to say?
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Good.
You all want to hear it. So basically, it's different hardware vendors making different things. So iWarp runs on top of TCP/IP, so it gets all the routability, transaction control, and it works in today's chaotic Ethernet that you don't need a lot of Ethernet. But it's another RDMA.
No, you need to have support in the hardware, of course.
No. All Mellanox.
You can say.
All Mellanox hardware since Connected 3 supports RoCE. RoCE version 2 is supported from RoCE, from Connected 3 Pro.
Yeah, but you need to have support.
You need
in
to
the hardware.
Have support in the driver, but the hardware from Connected 3 and up, which means Connected 3, Connected 3 Pro, and our newly 100 gig ConnectX 4 supports RoCE out of the box.
I know Chelsea and some other vendors have RoCE support. I just didn't know if it was something you could add after a product already exists or it needs to be designed with that.
So I'm not sure that, you know, I'm not talking for Chelsea, I'm not sure if they have it.
I work at Chelsea.
Oh, okay.
So we don't do RoCE.
So, all the people that I told them not to ask questions and come later, you can come now.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it. And thank you.